Dear friends, I am Dr. K. Kannan, Professor Mechanical Engineering, Anjaleyammal Mahalingam Engineering College, Koyilvanni. I am happy to meet you again in the video lecture on the subject Fluid Mechanics and Machines. We are discussing on hydraulic turbines. So this is lecture number 2 on the hydraulic turbines. So the topic for today's discussion, we are going to discuss about the Francis turbine, Kaplan turbine, the working principle of the Francis and the Kaplan turbine, work done by the water on the runner. So we'll be discussing about the draft tube theory, specific speed, unit quantities, performance curves of turbines and governing of turbines. We recap from the earlier lecture. In the previous lecture on the hydraulic turbines, we classified the turbine and we discussed about the head and efficiency, various efficiency of the turbines. We have drawn the velocity triangle for the Pelton turbine. So we have classified the turbine as axial, radial and mixer flow turbine. And we discussed about the Pelton wheel, Pelton turbine, which is an impulse turbine. So we calculate the work done efficiency of the Pelton turbine. The learning outcome for this lecture. So at the end of the lecture, the student will be able to calculate the power and efficiency of Francis turbine, calculate the power and efficiency of Kaplan turbine, discuss on the draft tube, and they will define the specific speed and unit quantities of the turbine. Francis turbine, so invented by Francis in the year 1847. Initially, the Francis turbine is inward flow reaction turbine. So later on, it is modified as mixer flow turbines. The water enters radially and leaves axially. And what we have shown here in the diagram, it is the mixed flow Francis turbine, that is modified Francis turbine. The various component or the parts of the Francis turbine are scroll casing, stay van, guide vane, runner and the draft tube. The outer casing, so this is what your outer casing, you find the outer casing from the top view, the water from the penstock enters this scroll casing. So next to this scroll casing, we have the stay vanes. So the black color vanes, blades are called as stay vanes. And then we have the guide vanes. Next to that, we have the guide vanes. So the guide vanes are hinged. So you look at the dotted line, they are hinged at the center. And inside you have the runner of the Francis turbine. So water from the penstock, it enters through the scroll casing. It run around the water runs around the scroll casing and enters the stay vanes. The purpose of the scroll casing is to direct or to distribute the water around the circumference of the runner. So the water enters here, it flows in this direction and it is circulated, it is distributed around the entire circumference of the runner. So the casing is made by cast steel or concrete, depending on the head available. So, if the head is more, higher head, then we will be going for, we will be using the concrete casing. And if the head is small, medium, then we can, we will be using the steel, cast steel as the material for the scroll casing. So, next to the scroll casing, we have the stay vanes. The number of stay vanes are 50% of the number of guide vanes. The purpose of the stay vanes is to guide the water, from the scroll casing to the guide vanes. The stay vanes are made by cast iron, cast steel or fabricated steel. So next to the stay vanes, we have the ring of guide vanes. The guide vanes, you look at the hinges at the center, so it is bolted and you have a hinge. The position of the guide vanes can be changed. So according to the load requirement, according to the power to be developed by the turbine, the amount of water admitted to the turbine is regulated by changing the position of the guide vanes. So the guide vanes are regulated, the position of the guide vanes are regulated by the governing mechanism of the turbine. So the guide vanes are made by cast steel or stainless steel. So next to that, we have the runner vane. So after the guide vane, the water enters the runner vane. So with the higher velocity, so because of the head is converted into velocity by means of the stay vane, scroll casing and then the guide vane. With the higher velocity, the water enters the runner. so which impinges on the runner blade, so which converts the kinetic energy of the water is converted into the power, mechanical power, mechanical rotation. The runner blades are made by stainless steel. Then we have the draft tube. So after producing power, the water leaves the runner and flows through the draft tube. So look at the cross section of the draft tube, it is constantly diverging. So the water leaves the runner with the higher kinetic energy. So the kinetic energy is converted into pressure by means of the draft tube. So we'll discuss more on the draft tube later stage. So draft tube is the constant enlarging cross sectional area which converts the velocity of the water into pressure. And look at this. So this is the running of the rotor of the runner of the Francis turbine, and this is how the Francis turbine is working. So the water from the dam through the penstock, it enters the Francis turbine, which makes the runner to rotate, and the mechanical power is connected to the electrical generator to produce electric energy, and then the electric energy is uploaded in the grid, so it is distributed further, and water from here outlet of the runner flows through the draft tube. So this passage is called as draft tube, where the cross sectional area is constantly increasing, and this is the runner of the Francis turbine. And to calculate the work done, now we have to calculate the work done and the efficiency of the Francis turbine. So for that, we have to draw the velocity triangle. So this is the inlet of the Francis turbine runner, and this is the outlet velocity triangle. So the water enters with the absolute velocity V1 with angle alpha, and the runner rotates at a speed U1. U1 is the peripheral speed at the inlet, and the vectorial sum of V1 and U1 is VR1, relative velocity, which makes an angle theta. Theta is the angle of the blade at the inlet, and V1 has got the two components, velocity components, the tangential velocity and the flow direction, flow velocity. So VF1 is the flow velocity at the inlet, VW1 is the tangential velocity at the inlet, and the fluid enters the runner blade and flows out, leaving the runner blade with the relative velocity VR2, and we have absolute velocity V2. VR2 makes an angle of phi. So phi is the outlet angle of the moving blade, and the U2 is the peripheral speed at the outlet, and we have the absolute velocity V2 at the outlet, which has two components, VW2 and VF2. VW2 is the tangential velocity at the outlet, and VF2 is the flow velocity at the outlet. And the inlet and the outlet velocity triangle are also shown here. So inlet velocity triangle and the outlet velocity triangle, and the torque exerted by the water on the wheel. So the torque equal to rate of change of angular momentum. So rate of change of angular momentum is, so the mass rho a into VF1 is the mass of the water, and the change in the velocity. So momentum at the inlet, so rho a VF1 into VW1 R1 minus, so rho a VF2 into VW2 R2. And the minus sign, because the VW2 is in the opposite direction. So the direction, in the direction of the runner, so VW2 is in the opposite direction. Now it becomes rho a VF1 VW1 R1 plus rho a VF2 into VW2 R2. So the flow velocity normally VF1 equal to VF2. Flow velocity is constant between inlet and the outlet. So it becomes rho a VF1 into VW1 R1 plus VW2 R2. Now the work done per second on the wheel, so W equal to torque into angular velocity. So torque already we have calculated, rho a VF1 into VW1 R1 plus VW2 R2 into omega is the angular velocity. Omega equal to 2 pi n by 60. So now omega U1 peripheral speed at the inlet equal to omega into R1, peripheral speed at the outlet U2 equal to omega into R2, and the area into VF1 equal to discharge. Now substituting all the values here, so the W work done or the power work done per second or the power equal to rho Q into VW1 U1 plus VW2 U2. So VW1 is the whirl velocity at the inlet, U1 is the peripheral speed of the runner at the inlet, and VW2 is the whirl velocity at the outlet, and U2 is the peripheral speed at the outlet of the runner. In general, the expression for the work done is given by so rho q into Vw1 u1 plus or minus Vw2 u2. So plus or minus, here it is plus, but here we are mentioning in general plus or minus, because the value of Vw2 depends on the angle of the outlet angle of the runner blade. So if the above equation positive sign taken, if the angle beta is an acute angle and negative sign is taken if angle beta is the obtuse angle. So it depends on the beta. Beta is the angle of absolute velocity at the outlet of the runner. Now when beta equal to 90 degree, this is called as radial discharge at the outlet, then Vw2 equal to 0. The work done per second becomes W equal to rho q into Vw1 u1. In majority of the design, the water is discharged radially in the Francis turbine. So, we will calculate W equal to rho q into Vw1 u1. Then the hydraulic efficiency of the Francis turbine. So, hydraulic eta H equal to runner power divided by the water power. So, the power produced by the runner divided by the water power. So, runner power we calculated rho q into Vw1 u1 plus or minus Vw2 u2 divided by water power equal to rho q g into H. So, that is the total power given by the water, and then this equal to simplifying. So, rho q is getting cancelled. So, Vw1 u1 plus Vw2 plus or minus Vw2 u2 divided by g into H. If the for radial discharge, when beta equal to 90 degree, then the hydraulic efficiency equal to Vw1 u1 divided by g into H. And this equation you have to remember. So, for majority of the problem, the beta will be 90 degree. It will be given that the radial discharge. So, we have to use this equation for calculating the efficiency of the hydraulic efficiency of the Francis turbine. The degree of reaction. So, in another parameter for the reaction turbine, the degree of reaction is defined as the ratio of pressure drop in the runner to the hydraulic work done on the runner. So, this value simplified expression R equal to 1 by 2 minus 1 by 2 into cot theta divided by cot alpha minus cot theta. So, cot theta is the blade angle at the runner angle at the inlet, and alpha is the nozzle angle or the angle of absolute velocity at the inlet of the runner. And for Francis turbine, the working proportion. So, the flow ratio is defined as ratio of flow velocity at the inlet to the spouting velocity. So, the psi equal to Vf1 divided by spouting velocity is square root of 2gh. And this value is in the range of 0.15 to 0.3. So, these are all the working proportion that you have to remember when you calculate the different parameters for the Francis turbine. And speed ratio is defined as Ku equal to U1 by square root of 2gh. So, U1 is the peripheral speed at the inlet and 2gh is the velocity. So, Ku, the speed ratio, is in the range of 0.6 to 0.9. The discharge from the turbine is given by, so Q equal to pi D1 B1 into Vf1, which is equal to pi D2 B2 into Vf2. So, pi D1 B1 is the flow area and the Vf1 is the flow velocity at inlet and the outlet. So, D is the diameter of the runner, B is the width of the runner, 1 and 2 are the inlet and the outlet of the runner respectively. If the thickness of the runner vanes are taken into account, normally we subtract the thickness of the runner vanes because it is negligible comparing with the diameter. But when you want to account, when you want to consider the thickness of the runner vane, runner blade, then the equation discharge becomes pi d1 into pi d1 minus n into t into b1 into Vf1. So, n is the number of runner vanes and t is the thickness of the runner vane blade, which is also equal to pi d2 minus n into t into b2 into Vf2, where n is the number of vanes and t is the thickness of the vane. So, head given by the head on the turbine. So, H equal to P1 by rho g plus V1 square by 2g. So, this is the head on the turbine. So, in all our calculation, we require the head on the Francis turbine that we have to calculate based on the data given. Sometimes they may directly give the head value, or they will give the inlet pressure and the inlet velocity, and we have to calculate the head of the Francis turbine. So, these are all the design procedure and the working of the Francis turbine. The next turbine is the Keplon turbine. So, it is invented or developed by Keplon. This is an example for axial flow hydraulic turbine. So this is axial flow. The previous Francis turbine, earlier it was inward flow radial turbine. So the recent or modified version of the Francis turbine is mixed flow turbine, where the water enters radially and leaves axially. So here Kaplan turbine, it is completely axial turbine. The water enters axially and leaves also axially. So axial entry and axial outlet. So look at the diagram for few seconds. So we have various components. So the first, the scroll casing. So next to that, we have the guide vanes, and then the runner vanes, and then we have the shaft. So look at the front view. So this is the scroll casing, and we have the guide vanes, and then the runner, and this is the shaft. So these are all the runner vanes, and this is the hub or the boss of the runner. The various components of the Kaplan turbine are scroll casing, guide vanes, runner, and the draft tube. So next to that, we have the draft tube. So draft tube, it is a constantly increasing cross sectional area, which converts the velocity into pressure. So we start from the scroll casing. So as in the Francis turbine, so the purpose of the scroll casing is to admit the water into the guide vanes around the circumference of the runner. So we have the water enters from the penstock. So it is running around the circumference of the runner. The Kaplan turbine, normally it is used for low head turbine. So when we have large quantity of water at lower head, we will be preferring the Kaplan turbine. And next to the scroll casing is made by cast steel or the concrete, depending on the head available. So for a very, very high head, we will be using concrete. Normally we use the concrete because the large quantity of water will be handled by the Kaplan turbine. So the concrete or the cast steel, it is a material for scroll casing. Next to the scroll casing, we have the guide vanes. So the guide vanes, so we can rotate about the axis of the guide vane. As in the Francis turbine, we can rotate the change the position of the guide vanes. So by changing the position, the water quantity can be regulated. So the quantity of water can be regulated to the runner. So to produce the power, depending on the power requirement, we have to control the quantity of water. That is partially done by the guide vane in the Kaplan turbine. And the guide vanes are made by cast steel or the stainless steel material. Then next we have the runner. So runner blade also can be rotated about the center. Using the servo motor mechanism of the governing system of the turbine, we can change the position of the runner blade so that we can control the power generated by the Kaplan turbine. The runner blade is made by stainless steel or cast steel. Next to that, we have the draft tube, so which is the passage of diverging passage, which increases the pressure at the expense of by reducing the velocity of the water leaving the runner. And this is the runner of the Kaplan turbine, which is rotating about the center. And this is how the runner blade are adjusted about its axis. So using the servo motor mechanism, so that we can regulate the quantity of water flow across the runner of the Kaplan turbine. And the work done by the Kaplan turbine is given by W equal to rho Q into VW1 U1. So VW1 is the virl velocity at the inlet, U1 is the peripheral speed of the runner, and the Q is the discharge, rho is the density. The hydraulic efficiency of the Kaplan turbine is given by hydraulic efficiency eta H equal to runner power divided by the water power. So rho Q into VW1 U1 divided by rho Q GH, which is VW1 U1 divided by G into H. And working proportion of the Kaplan turbine, U1 equal to U2 equal to pi dN by 60, where D is the diameter of the runner, N is the speed of the runner in RPM, and the velocity. So the velocity of flow at inlet and the outlet equal VF1 equal to VF2, the discharge Q, so Q equal to pi by 4 D square, capital D square minus small d square into VF1, so where capital D is the outer diameter of the runner, and small d is the diameter of the hub. So you have to remember this equation for Kaplan turbine. So Q equal to pi by 4 capital D square minus small d square into VF1. So these are all the working proportion of the Kaplan turbine. So when you in solving problems, all these equations are required that you have to remember. And the various losses in the hydraulic turbine. So in the impulse turbine, in the case of impulse turbine, the head loss in the penstock, head loss in the nozzle, head losses in the due to the blade friction, hydraulic losses due to the blade friction, eddy formation, energy contained by the water leaving the draft tube, and leakage losses. Mechanical losses are bearing friction. So head loss in the penstock. So there will be friction when the water is flowing through the penstock. There will be friction on the surface of the penstock. So because of the friction, there will be loss of head. That is what head loss in the penstock. And similarly, in the impulse turbine, the head loss in the nozzle. It is again flow through the nozzle. So there will be frictional losses in the nozzle. That is accounted as head loss in the nozzle. And various hydraulic losses are blade friction losses, eddy formation. So because of the circulatory flow in the in water flow, the eddy formation, that is what eddy formation, because of that there will be loss of energy, and energy contained by the water leaving the draft tube. So the water is leaving with a certain kinetic energy, so it is also a loss, and leakage losses in the joints. And mechanical losses, we have bearings, so the shaft is supported by the bearings, so there will be mechanical losses in the bearings, that is bearing friction losses. And in the case of reaction turbine, like your Francis turbine and the Kaplan turbine, the various losses are head loss in the penstock, again due to the friction, hydraulic losses like blade friction, eddy formation, friction in the draft tube, and the energy contained by the water leaving the draft tube, disc friction, that is friction on the runner blade, and the leakage losses. Mechanical losses are bearing friction losses. So these are all the different types of losses occurring in the hydraulic turbine. And now we compare impulse and the reaction turbine. So impulse turbine, the example is Pelton turbine. Reaction turbine, the example is Francis turbine and the Kaplan turbine or the propeller turbine. So in the impulse turbine, all the available hydraulic energy is converted into kinetic energy by the nozzle that forms the free jet. So this is impulse turbine. Reaction turbine, the portion of the fluid energy is converted into kinetic energy before the fluid enters the turbine runner. So there will be pressure drop in the stay vane, guide vane, as well as in the runner vane. So that is what reaction turbine. In the impulse turbine, the turbine operates at atmospheric pressure. So but here the water enters the runner with a higher pressure. Both the pressure and velocity changes as the water passes through the runner. So in the impulse turbine, the runner is open to the atmosphere. So the operating pressure is atmospheric pressure. In the case of impulse turbine, water may be allowed to enter a part or the whole wheel of the circumference. So it is allowed. So only at the bottom of the, it is impulse turbine is a tangential flow turbine. So the water enters the runner tangentially, not around the circumference of the runner. Whereas in the case of reaction turbine, water is admitted over the circumference of the runner. So water is entering through the entire circumference of the runner. The wheel does not run full and the air has free access to the bucket. So in the case of impulse turbine, whereas here the water is completely filled the van passage throughout the operation of the turbine. There is no possibility of air entering into the runner blade because it is completely covered with the casing. Casing has no hydraulic function in the case of impulse turbine. It is only serves to prevent the splashing and guide the water to the tail race. Whereas here the pressure changes takes place from inlet to the outlet of the turbine. The casing is essential. So casing in the case of reaction, in the case of Francis and the Kaplan turbine, the casing converts the head into pressure. So head into pressure. So because you look at the cross section, head into velocity. So look at the cross section, the cross section of the casing is gradually decreasing. So which converts into velocity. The head is converted into velocity. Unit is installed above the tail race in the case of impulse turbine. So tail race is the water level at the outlet of the turbine. So in the case of reaction turbine, the unit is kept entirely submerged in the water below the tail race. Flow regulation is possible without losses in the case of impulse turbine. Flow regulations is always accomplished by the losses in the case of reaction turbine. So relative velocity remains constant across the runner blade, but here in the reaction turbine, relative velocity changes across the runner blade. So VR1, VR2, they are the relative velocity at the inlet and the outlet. So in the case of impulse turbine, VR1 equal to VR2, but here VR1 is not equal to VR2 in the case of reaction turbine. So these are all the comparison, various points of comparison between impulse and the reaction turbine. Then next we discuss the draft tube. The draft tube is a passage of gradually increasing cross-sectional area which connects the outlet of the runner to the tail race. So the outlet of the runner is connected to the tail. The tail race is the water level at the outlet of the runner. The purpose of the draft tube are as follows: to permit the negative head or suction head to be established in the runner exist, thus making it possible to install the turbine above the tail race level without loss of the head. That is first purpose. Second, to convert the velocity energy of the water leaving the runner into pressure energy. So we have to establish negative head or the suction head to be established the runner exists, so that we can install the turbine above the tail race. That is the first purpose. Second purpose, convert, so the water is leaving the runner with the higher kinetic energy, higher velocity, so the velocity is to be converted into pressure, so by means of draft tube. So that is why the draft tube has got the gradually enlarging, increasing cross sectional area. And these are all the different types of draft tube available, but the fourth one is very popular in the Francis and the Kaplan turbine. So simple conical draft tube, and this is simple elbow type of draft tube, and the Moody spreading draft tube. So there is only entry and two outlet, and this is circular cross section at the entry and rectangular cross section at the outlet. So this is again draft tube with the circular inlet and the rectangular outlet. So these are all the different types of draft tube used in the hydraulic turbines. And in the draft tube, so we have to calculate the head. So you look at here, this is the turbine casing, outlet of the turbine. The water enters here from the runner, and we have the tail race level, water level at the outlet of the turbine, and y is the height of the water above the datum, and h is the head. Now applying the Bernoulli's equation, p1 by rho g plus v1 square by 2g plus hs plus y equal to p2 by rho g plus v2 square by 2g plus hf. So hf is the head loss due to the friction. So p1 by rho g, the head at which the pressure head at which the what is pressure head at the outlet of the turbine is calculated from here. So p2 equal to atmospheric pressure. So pa by rho g minus hs minus v1 square by 2g minus v2 square by 2g minus hf. So this is the pressure head at the outlet of the turbine. The efficiency of the draft tube is defined as the ratio of actual conversion of kinetic head into pressure head in the draft tube to the kinetic head at the inlet of the draft tube. So the efficiency equal to the conversion. So v1 square by 2g minus v2 square by 2g minus hf. This is the actual conversion of kinetic energy into pressure energy, and the hf is the head loss due to the friction, and divided by the kinetic energy at the inlet of the draft tube is v1 square by 2g. So this is the efficiency of the draft tube. Now we define specific speed of the turbine. So the specific speed is the important parameter for the selection of the turbine. So based on the specific speed, we will select the particular turbine. Specific speed of any turbine is the speed in RPM of a turbine geometrically similar to the actual turbine, but of such a size that under corresponding condition it will develop 1 kilowatt power when working under unit head. So the speed of the turbine we will define like this. The speed of the turbine, the specific speed defined as the speed of the turbine when it produces 1 kilowatt of power when working under a unit head, one head of water. So ns equal to n into square root of p divided by h to the power 5 by 4. So n is the speed and RPM, p is the power developed by the turbine, h is the head available to the turbine. So ns equal to n into square root of p divided by h to the power 5 by 4. And the unit quantities, first we calculate the unit power. The unit power is defined as the power developed by the given turbine when working under head of 1 meter. So, P equal to P divided by H to the power 3 by 2. And the unit speed, the speed of the turbine, the unit speed is defined as the speed of the given turbine when the working under head of 1 meter. So, Nu equal to N divided by square root of H. So, these are all the non-dimensional parameters used for comparing the turbine. Specific speed, unit power and the unit speed, they are the non-dimensional parameter used for comparing different types of turbines. And unit discharge is the discharge defined as the discharge of the given turbine when working under head of 1 meter. So Qu equal to Q divided by square root of H. So Q is the discharge, H is the head available to the turbine. The next we discuss about the governing of hydraulic turbine. So for Pelton turbine, Francis turbine and the Keplon turbine, we discuss the governing mechanism. So the governing mechanism, why we have to govern the turbine? So the turbine, the power requirement of the turbine, power produced by the turbine will be varying according to the load requirement. When the turbine is installed for a particular capacity, the power is produced continuously by the hydraulic turbine. So when the load, the distribution point, when the load changes, load increases or decreases, accordingly the power produced by the turbine should be regulated, otherwise it will become waste. So automatically it is to be regulated, the power produced by the turbine should be regulated. For regulating the power produced by the turbine, we require a hydraulic, governing mechanism installed with the turbine. And this is the arrangement for the Pelton turbine. So this is called a servo motor mechanism. So again, look, this is the relay control or the control, and this is what is called as relay cylinder or the servo motor. So this is called a servo motor mechanism. So we have a centrifugal governor, so which is, we have a sleeve and we have a lever here, and the turbine main shaft is connected to the governor shaft. The turbine speed is given here, the governor will be rotating. So about the vertical axis, it is rotated, the governor is rotating, and we have a lever. Lever is connected to the fulcrum. So here we have a fulcrum and lever. About the lever is moving up and down about the fulcrum, and we have the relay or the control valve. And here we have three openings at the center, at the top and the bottom. And the center opening is connected with the oil pump, gear oil pump. Through the gear oil, using the gear oil pump, the oil will be circulated here. And we have two valves, V1 and V2. And the V1 is connected to the right side of the plunger, and V2 is connected to the left side of the plunger. So side B and side A of the plunger. And we have a piston rod or relay cylinder, piston rod of the relay cylinder, and at the end of the relay, end of the piston cylinder, piston rod, we have a spear. The spear is closing or opening the nozzle. So this is the nozzle of the Pelton wheel, and we have the penstock. So from the water from the penstock enters the nozzle, and the nozzle opening is changed. The cross sectional area of the opening is changed by means of the spear control. So how the mechanism is working? In the normal working condition, so everything will go as designed. So the water will be leaving the nozzle, and it will form the jet, and the jet will be impinging on the bucket and produces the power. When the load on the turbine decreases, the speed of the runner will increase. When the load decreases, the speed will increase, and the fly ball will move in the upward direction. As the speed is increasing, the fly ball will move in the upward direction, which makes the sleeve to move in the upward direction. When the sleeve is moving, the lever is also moving in the upward direction. On the left side, it is moving in the upward direction, and the right side is moving in the downward direction. When it is moving on the downward direction, the right side, so what will happen? Valve V1 will be closed, valve V2 will be open. So because by the control valve, V2 will be open. So when the valve V2 is open, the oil from here flows through the V2 on the left side of the plunger, that is side A. When the oil enters here, so it makes the piston to move towards this, piston to move towards the right side, so which will close the nozzle. So when the load decreases, the speed of the governor increases, speed of the turbine increases, speed of the governor is increasing, the fly balls are moving in the upward direction, which makes the lever on the left side to move in the upward direction. And because of the fulcrum, the lever portion on the right side will be moving downward, which makes the valve V2 to open, and the oil from the oil pump, through the oil pump, enters through the V2, flows to the side A, which makes the piston to move in the right hand direction, which will close the spear. So the spear will be moving forward, which will close the nozzle, so that the water admitted to the turbine reduces. On the other side, when the turbine load increases, the speed will decrease. When the speed decreases, the fly ball will be moving downward. So the lever on the left side will be moving downward, and here it is moving in the upward direction. So lever on the right side will be moving in the upward direction. Now V1 will be open. When the V1 is open, so the oil enters here and flows to the side B, which makes the piston to move backward. So the spear is drawn back, and the nozzle opening will be more, there will be more flow of the water. So depending on the load condition, so the control mechanism, the servo motor mechanism will regulate the flow of water to the turbine so that the power produced by the turbine will be regulated. And in the case of Francis turbine, as we discussed earlier, the servo motor, so the entire mechanism, we have the governing mechanism, the entire mechanism is connected to the servo motor mechanism, and the servo motor will regulate the guide vanes of the runner blade. So we have the guide vane, the position of the guide vanes are changed by means of the servo motor by the lever. So we have a regulating shaft here and regulating lever. So the regulating lever will be tilted so that the position of the guide vanes are changed, so that the amount of water admitted to the turbine is regulated according to the load on the turbine. And in the case of Keplan turbine, there are two methods for governing the Keplan turbine. One is regulating the guide vanes as in the Francis turbine, and regulating the runner blade about its own axis using the servo motor mechanism. So using the two method, the Keplan turbine is regulated. So the governing mechanism is inbuilt with the turbine for regulating the power produced by the turbine. So we stop here. So these are all the books I published in the fluid mechanical engineering subject, and you may find fluid mechanics and machinery is very useful for this subject. You can refer to it for additional information and more problem in the subject. And I have a YouTube channel where I upload the video lectures on the subject. You can subscribe the channel and use the videos for your better learning. So thank you for watching. So please post your comments on the comments box. You subscribe the channel, and you can contact me through my mail ID or WhatsApp number for further information on the subject. So we'll meet again in another video lecture on solving problem on the Keplan turbine and the Francis turbine.